Welcome back to another episode of Introductory Organic Chemistry. Today we're going to talk about sulfur ilides and the Korey-Chekhovsky reaction. But before we get into that, let's go through the practice problems that I assigned last lecture. So in this first problem, we have to rank the four following compounds in order of decreasing acidity. As well, we also have to identify the most acidic proton in each case. So looking at these, there's a couple that are pretty close. This protonated amine and this beta-ketoester are pretty close in terms of acidity. Depending on the amine, this might actually be less acidic, but in this case, it's more acidic. We also have an OH. OHs are generally quite acidic. It just depends on what's connected to them, but alcohols tend to have a pKa around 16-ish. And finally, we have this ester, which is not that acidic relatively compared to everything else here. So in order of decreasing acidity, we start with the protonated amine, which is called a morpholine. We have the beta-ketoester, followed by isopropanol, and finally ethyl acetate. In this next problem, I want you to determine whether or not acetate is able to deprotonate acetylacetone, which is commonly referred to as ACAC, especially by inorganic chemists. And so in this case, this should not occur because acetic acid has a pKa of 5, while ACAC has a pKa of 9. And that's four orders of magnitude difference. This is not going to happen to any significant extent. In this final problem, I want you to propose a base for the following reaction. And the base that I would use is LDA, which is the most common base used for deprotonating ketones. And the reason that this reaction will work is acetophenone has a pKa of 25, while the protonated form of LDA, diisopropylamine, has a pKa of 36. So that's 11 orders of magnitude. This is going to work quite well. Now let's get to today's material, sulfur ilides and the Korey-Chekhovsky reaction. So what is the Korey-Chekhovsky? Most of the time when you hear this reaction, you'll probably think of the formation of an epoxide from an aldehyde or a ketone using a sulfur ilide. This is probably the most common use of the Korey-Chekhovsky, although there are a couple other variants that you could do, such as the treatment of imines with a sulfonium ilide, which forms an aziridine, and aziridines are like epoxides just with nitrogen instead of oxygen. Additionally, you could do addition into a Michael acceptor, which will form a cyclopropane. But in this case, instead of using a typical sulfonium, we use a sulfonium oxide. And this will just usually add to the alkene instead of the ketone. So there's two different types, as I just highlighted. There's the typical sulfonium ilide, which is just an alkylated thioether that's been deprotonated. However, you can also have the corresponding sulfoxide derivative. And sulfoniums tend to be harder, and they tend to do 1-2 addition. So this would be the typical sulfonium ilide. However, if you use the sulfonium oxide ilide, these are softer and tend to do 1-4 addition, if possible. However, if you don't have any Michael acceptors present, these will still react and form epoxides with ketones and aldehydes. So in general, these are relatively good nucleophiles when you compare them to other nucleophiles in organic chemistry, especially the DMSO-derived sulfonium ilide. You can see this has an N of almost 22, and that is extremely nucleophilic. That's on the upper end of nucleophiles with N parameters that have been experimentally determined. It's also worth noting, however, that there's only 10 sulfur ilides in the data set of N parameters, which means that we don't have as good of an idea of what the general range of reactivity for sulfur ilides is. Now, that being said, in the literature, there's still relatively few sulfonium ilides that have seen widespread use. Usually they're seen in total synthesis, and so those have been used as a one-off most of the time. However, the DMSO-derived sulfonium ilide is quite commonly used. Okay, so let's look at the simplest ilide. We can see why most ketones will react. So you can see that this has an N of about 21, and most ketones have a range between minus 23 and minus 15. However, there's not that many ketones in the data set, so you have to take that with a grain of salt. Now, if you recall from our earlier lecture on nucleophilicity, which I'll include a card to here, the N plus E should sum to a greater than minus 5 value. And this is for any kinetic rate to actually be occurring, like at a statistically significant amount. And so you can see based on the available data, we're going to usually be in the range of minus 2 to plus 7 for this sulfonium ilide. And so this will react with most ketones and aldehydes without any issue. And in general, even though there's no aldehydes with experimentally determined N parameters, with the exception of benzaldehyde and benzaldehyde in the presence of Lewis acids, aldehydes are generally far more reactive than ketones, so aldehydes will have no problem reacting with this ilide. So the mechanism of this reaction is first the carbonyl or imine reacts with the sulfonium ilide, kind of the same way a Grignard reaction would. However, the oxygen or the nitrogen is able to attack back and displace this sulfonium as a leaving group, kicking off thioether as a byproduct and forming an epoxide or an aziridine respectively. Now, it's worth noting that this is technically a reversible process till the thioether leaves. Once the thioether leaves, these typically wouldn't reopen in a ziridine or an epoxide. Now, if we wanted to do the cyclopropanation, you might be wondering, if it's such a good nucleophile, why do we tend to get 1,4 addition over 1,2 addition? And the reason for that is this is a reversible process. Just like in the case of the epoxide and a ziridine formation, you can see that this sulfonium oxide can add, but then it can also be given back off. And so as long as this equilibrium is happening, it's able to convert back to the free sulfonium illid form, and this can also add in a 1,4 fashion. And once this adds in a 1,4 fashion, we don't typically see additional addition to form an epoxide. And I'm not totally sure why that is. It could be due to steric effects, but I'm not quite sure why that is. You might expect that if these do react with ketones, that this ketone should still react, but this might be something that's controlled through equivalence of the reagent used. Now, something to consider is the utility of this versus the Wittig or the Horner-Wadsworth-Emmons reaction. And so in the case of a Wittig or an HWE, when you add this to a ketone or an aldehyde, we actually lose the oxygen, and that's transferred to the phosphorus, forming a phosphine oxide as well as your alkene product. Now, in the case of sulfur illids, the oxygen tends to be retained. And so this is a neat reaction to access epoxides versus alkenes. Just depending on which reagent you use, you're going to get different products. Now, one thing to consider is when you're generating these illids, or the sulfonium salts that are the precursor to the illids, is if you have different R groups connected to your sulfonium with alpha protons that are similarly acidic, you can get mixtures of epoxide or Korychekovsky products in general. And so one trick that you can do is, if you're using an electron withdrawing group on your sulfonium, these protons here will be much more acidic than the corresponding ones on the other positions. And so you should only be deprotonating this position. Now, if you wanted to be really careful and just make sure that there's zero chance that that would happen, if you have a bulky group without any alpha proton such as a phenyl, this will make it so that only one CH2 is present that can even be deprotonated from, or CH in the case of a more substituted sulfonium. Now, usually, if you see some special cases like the Trost illid, which we'll talk about in a bit, they will make derivatives of diphenyl sulfide for this exact reason. So if we wanted to prepare a sulfonium illid, one of the ways that you can do that is through the alkylation or the aerylation of a thioether. Now, one consideration is you could use a reagent such as diaryl iodonium salts. In the presence of copper 2 benzoate, these tend to add quite well. However, I couldn't find the original paper where this is done. If you do find the original paper, message me in the comment section and I will pin that comment. So these are earlier papers from like 1970s, but I think that this might be an even older reaction, but I couldn't track down the original paper. So one of the things that matters a lot for these salts is what your counter ion is. So in this case, we would have tetrafluoroborate as a counter ion. That's not a very good nucleophile, so it should be a fairly stable salt. However, if you did something like iodide, which is a really good nucleophile, you could actually like cleave your sulfonium back to a thioether. So like if you tried methylating with iodomethane, for instance, you'd get sulfonium iodide, and those could very easily convert back to a thioether and iodomethane. So you'd want to use something like a triflate or a perchlorate, or more ideally a tetrafluoroborate or a hexafluorophosphate. However, one consideration is you might not actually need to isolate these. So if you had something like benzyl bromide, you might be able to just use a catalytic thioether, which would be able to slowly convert to the sulfonium, which could be deprotonated, and then eventually form your epoxides. So you might not actually need to isolate your illids, but if you do want to isolate them to get really good control, you have to make sure that you use a counter ion that's going to be inert. So sulfonium oxide salts are less universally preparable, and what I mean by that is there's very few examples of derivatives of them prepared, and when they have prepared derivatives, they've been through really obscure mechanisms. Now, the reason for this is sulfoxides can act as a sulfur nucleophile as well as an oxygen nucleophile, and depending on the nature of the electrophile and the conditions that are used, you can get S alkylation or O alkylation. If you're using an alkylating agent in the presence of silver, for instance, you tend to get alkylation at oxygen rather than sulfur. If you react DMSO with iodomethane in the absence of silver, you'll get alkylation at sulfur. But if you react DMSO with iodomethane in the presence of silver, like silver perchlorate, you're going to get alkylation at the oxygen of DMSO. So once you get the salt, the derivative, which we were talking about earlier, and we convert it to an illid, what you can do is you can treat it with a base, get your illid, and then acylate that. So this is a really good nucleophile, remember, with like an N of 21. This will easily react with an acyl chloride. And as long as you control stoichiometry, you should be able to just add one equivalent of this. And then you have a good sulfonium illid. So this is one way to make a sulfonium oxide illid that's been seen in the literature in several instances. And so this is the main type of derivative that you'll see. One other way that I've seen in the literature is the treatment of sulfonium salts with certain oxidants, such as MCPBA, some ruthenium oxidants. However, these are very few and far between. And so if you want to see some examples of this, you can look at this paper here where they make some derivatives like the triethyl and the tributyl, etc., derivatives of the DMSO anion, just with multiple R groups that are different than methyl. Now, finally, if you want to deprotonate a sulfonium illid, sulfonium salt to get an illid, usually what you'll see is people use sodium hydride and DMSO. And this is not a safe approach. I would recommend that you watch my video on using sodium hydride in DMSO, DMF, and dimethylacetamide, as this can lead to explosions, especially when there's heat applied. Now, the next most common base is likely potassium tert-butoxide. And there's a massive difference in pKa here, and you can see the same reaction going with sodium hydride or with potassium tert-butoxide. So I would say play it safe, just make sure that your potassium tert-butoxide is dry or prepare it fresh, and then just use this instead of sodium hydride. Massive difference in pKa, it works fine. Now, if you have a really acidic sulfonium, you can use potassium hydroxide. There's cases where this is done in water without any issue. Additionally, when I was taught about the Korychekovsky, it was from an older chemist, and when they were doing research, it was usually done with N-butyl, except N-butyl is also overkill and it can do other reactions. So let's look at some examples of Korychekovsky epoxidation. So in this first example, you can see that DMSO-derived sulfonium oxide iodide is able to form an epoxide on this ketone without any issue and on an 18-kilogram scale, which is massive. In this other example, we have a case where we have a ketone, which is a derivative of cholesterol, and this is able to undergo epoxidation, forming a single enantiomer of this product and a single diastereomer. Now, in this next case, we have this funky looking isoindazole, which is kind of cool. Plus, it's also like a hydrazine. So, this is kind of like an azide derived motif. This is kind of cool. Now, the not cool thing is that these people use sodium hydride and DMSO with heat. Okay, no THF, no other co-solvent to make this less reactive. But a really neat product. Like, if I asked you how you'd make that, you probably wouldn't instantly think, I would make an imine and then do a Korychekovsky. But you know, maybe if you've been doing a lot of chemistry, that would come to mind. But for me, this wouldn't be super intuitive. Now, in this next example, this comes from a paper where they use this trifluoroethyl-derived sulfonium, and what they do is they just make it into trifluoromethylated azuridines, and these are done with good diastereo selectivity, although the products are racemic. This is a cool way to introduce CF3 groups. Now, in the case of cyclopropanation, some examples include the cyclopropanation of this indole-containing Michael acceptor, as well as the cyclopropanation of this cinnamate derivative. It also has a CF2, and the way that they prepared the CF2 was from the corresponding aldehyde with a carboxylic acid, and it was like a pretty clever use of deoxyfluor. Now, there have been some chiral variations using catalytic or stoichiometric amounts of thioethers. And if you're interested in looking at a review that discusses those, here's one from Agarwal's group. Finally, I wanted to talk about the Trost illid. So if you haven't heard of the Trost illid before, this is a really clever reagent. And so the way that they make this is first they react this diphenyl thioether with this primary alkyl iodide, which undergoes displacement in the presence of silver tetrafluoroborate to form this tetrafluoroborate salt. Then, upon subsequent deprotonation with sodium hydride, the sulfonium illid is formed, but the illid can do an intramolecular SN2 reaction and displace this chloride as a leaving group, forming the Trost illid as a product. So this is the Trost illid in orange here. Really cool reagent, and there's been a reported org synth prep of this reagent if you wanted to make it yourself. You don't need to just alkylate it with like cyclopropyl iodide. This is just like a way to get around more niche reagents. Plus, you might open that cyclopropane under really nucleophilic conditions. Okay, so what can you do with the Trost illid? I will include some references in the description about uses of the Trost illid. What you can see is instead of just getting an epoxide, you get an epoxide with a cyclopropane, which can then undergo Hausse-Meinwald rearrangement, which is a pinnacle type rearrangement of epoxides forming ketones or aldehydes in the presence of an acid or a Lewis acid. And for these, because they're so strained, these can typically just be accomplished using only lithium as a Lewis acid. So for this lecture, I'd like to assign a few practice problems. These will all be multi-step synthesis problems today. So in this first case, starting with 1,3,5-trimethoxybenzene, prepare the corresponding product on the right. You can use common reagents and reactions that we've discussed in this course so far. I don't want you to just do like a coupling reaction of this piece and the other piece via some sort of palladium coupling. I want you to build it stepwise using the reactions we talked about so far. And if you really like the style of these problems, and if you think that they're a sufficient difficulty, like the pinned comment where I will ask you guys, is this too easy or too hard? If you think it's too hard, make sure you dislike that pinned comment. Now in this next problem, we take tert-butylbenzene and we treat it with a series of different reagents, and essentially I want you to show what the product is at each step. Just fill in the blanks. Now in this final problem, we have the use of a trost illid with a ketone in a multi-step synthesis that was reported in Orglet. This is quite a good paper. It was done by Eric Carrera's group, and this really highlights the utility of the reactions that we've talked about so far. So hopefully this should challenge you, and it shouldn't be too unfair overall. So with that, I hope that this has been a useful lecture on the Korey-Tchaikovsky reaction of sulfur illids. And if you have any questions or comments, I'd encourage you to leave them below. And it would really help out the channel if you left a like and subscribed. Have a great day.